Hello and welcome, my friends. Yeah, today I'm gonna feature a replay of yesterday's stream, which I played in my tier 8 French cruiser, heavy cruiser, the Charles Martel. And yeah, as the title says, it says, if top tiers lift their weight, what does it mean? Well, I'm always telling the people, if you are top tier, it's expected then you do that you do a bit more than the mid or low tier ships, because you can, and you have a significant advantage over them in this regard. So you're way, way more capable. And that exactly happened in this game. One of the protagonists is me, and the other one is this Atago here. And as you can clearly see, we are playing Land of Fire without caps, so just standard battle. The Charles Martel has a okay-ish concealment, I would say, with 10.7 km, and yeah, but that's not the stealthiest concealment. The Targo, on the other hand, has 9.3 if he's full concealment build, which I hope he has. And normally it's enough if you have, since you can't slot the, oh, you can actually, so if he has slotted the module and the captain perk, then it should be fine. So I communicate with him that I need him a spot on the front to see what's going on. I just think that probably our destroyer is also coming in this way. It's only one destroyer and a carrier in the game, so our carrier is working on the other side, so we have to get what we can to create our own spotting. And of course the stealthiest ship is a good possibility to do that. The Bismarck is leaving us, but I don't care too much. Since we are top tier, we can also do our work pretty well if we are paying attention. Also, what is really positive, I mean, I'm always talking about the negative aspects if someone doesn't answer in the chat, or it's always good if you have someone that at least responds to your questions or to what you say, I mean, regarding the game. Because that's actually what I like about this teamwork and about online games. If you have someone who's slightly competent and is doing or knows what his ship is capable of, and therefore is doing the right things, more or less the right things. I mean, I don't expect everyone to be a like super Unicom player, as I said very often already. I just mentioned that it is always good to have someone who understands at least what's going on. Yeah, I don't know why the Kagero is shooting the fishy. That's definitely not recommended, but okay. So, we get at least some spotting. Kagero is paying probably the price. Nah, he's safe. He turned away in time, so everything is fine. I see a King George here. King George with HE can be a super annoying thing. The other thing is that the King George isn't capable of overmatching me, because he has only 356 mm guns and I have a 25 mm bow. But the next target will be the Atago, because he's making life for my Atago difficult. So I use my reload booster, which the Charles Martel has also, since all the French cruisers from tier 6 on are using this. And the enemy Atago, super lucky that he doesn't eat too many torps, because, my fellow Atago aimed them pretty nicely, but they just run out 10 meters in front of him, so he would have been already dead, and so on and so on. So as I said, my Atago is under fire, so I have to take this opportunity to pummel the enemy as well. Because it's never a good thing if your team is or teammate is getting shot at and you don't return the favor, unless you are full super low HP or so. But if he gets shot at, you want to shoot the enemy as well, so they can't farm free damage. This is really important. All right, King George switched to HE, which is of course working against me. The Richelieu is shooting me from I think 20 km, so I have to be aware of this as well. And therefore I'm turning away for now. Not bothering. I'm waiting for the opportunity. Yeah, that's one of the problems of the Charmatel, also on the Algerie and on the most of the French cruisers, except for the HIV, the Henri on the tier 10, they tend to lose the rudder when getting shot at by heavy HE, so 203 mm and above, or even IFHE HE shells. Doesn't make too much fun. The thing is, I have Last Stand. This is back in the days when we played Tier 8 competitive. I trained a captain explicitly for the Charmatel, because I played it at that point, and I used, of course, Last Stand on it to be still maneuverable. Yeah, and this Fitchy is doing a really, really bad mistake. His smoke runs out. Now he reverses backward. That's of course really bad. You see it. He can't even angle against 203 mm. And yeah, there he goes. Two salvos. I think the Otago finished him off. And yeah, he's history. So this reload booster is exactly for these meant to be for these exact situations. You can really, really do well in such. Or you can capitalize on these situations when someone is doing a big mistake and so on. My Otago finishes off the enemy Otago, and now it looks pretty good on this side, and we are we could push here. And that's what we definitely do. For now at least. I mean, if you look at the map, the right side is I wouldn't say wavering or having troubles, but they have to fight them at superior force. That means now when we have like made ourselves a superior force, we can actually do some really nasty work. So we have Amagi and Roma pushing in front, which is actually okay. They absorb damage while the cruisers, in this case at Kedatago, is leaving towards the middle to probably kill the Ognivoy. But I can use this kind of shield to farm damage behind them. And that's what I'm doing right now. Maybe some words about the Charmatel itself. It's perfect ship that when it comes to long-drawn games, where you can use your HE capabilities and farm battleships or other targets that are not so maneuverable over the range. That's when the French cruisers shine, and the Charmatel is one of these ships where I would say that's definitely the case. And makes the French line really, really enjoyable to play. I mean, the Algerie is also fine, but it's more solid. The Charmatel is a bit faster, so in this regard, it's a bit more... yeah, not intuitive, but... bit more comfortable to play. You have also a higher top speed, I think, of almost 40 knots if you have speed boost activated, and yeah. The only thing you have to to watch out is that you don't overextend, because that's going to happen really quickly if you play with the or if you play with speed boost. And now I figured, oops, okay, now the Richelieu found me as a target. So I have to be a bit more careful. Thing is here, I expected the Roma and Amagi to push you more, and now I'm sitting more or less alone here. So my goal is here, waiting out the next salvo from the Richelieu. Hopefully don't get completely wrecked. I have my speed boost available, this is good. I will activate him, so his salvo is out as soon as I survive the salvo somehow. I was lucky. He citadeled me straight through the front, and now I will turn away because I can't afford to go closer, and my so-called protection from the Amagi and Roma is more or less gone because they moved somewhere else. So I have to deal now alone with the Richelieu. But he's pretty low, he has two fires ticking, and this aim was questionable. And now I don't fear him anymore, because now he has to wait another 30 seconds, which is one of the big downsides of the Richelieu. until he gets his next Sabo out. And before that, I was able to finish him, and so therefore saved my life more or less. The closer he gets, the more complicated it becomes. Even though the Richelieu isn't known to be super precise, but on these ranges, even Richelieu is pretty precise, and he has the pen to penetrate me from everywhere on this distance. This is really, really dangerous. All right, so yeah, I expect my Amagi and Roma to be able to finish off this King George by themselves, and I will head back towards our base. Because if you saw it here, the enemy broke through, and yeah. Now my Atago, wisely decision he made, is yeah, kiting them here probably. My carrier is running, the hood is kiting them, so we have kind of a defense here, but I want to enforce it. These two battleships are going for the cap. Well, you could say what you want, but I mean I'm fine for the moment because that distracts the enemy as well. It splits up their forces. The carrier alone can reset them from time to time, but not all the time. And they need to send more ships over there. So, in this regard, it's fine. I know that the Targo knows what he's doing. That's a good thing as well. So I expect him not to die immediately, which is always helpful. If he would be like an average player, then I would be a bit more concerned. Or if I don't know how he plays, then this becomes even more urgent. But as you see, he just finished off one target, the Dallas. So as I said, pretty good. I also asked him how's the HP down there, friendly and enemy, because that tells me, okay, do I need to be there or is the Tirpitz pretty healthy? Then he probably needs some help. If not, then I have to not bother. And as you see, the Richelieu is coming back here. I mean, you could argue these two are on a crossfire. The thing for the King George, or the unpleasant thing for the King George, is that he can't angle against an Amagi or a Roma. They overmatch his armor everywhere. So he's, unless he's firing HE all the time and plays it safe, he's basically a non-factor and will go down over time. So I think this is also pretty safe. The only worry we should have is the Richelieu. Concentrare il fuoco sulla nave nemica. Yep, because he's pretty full HP. I'm using my speed boost. And now I decide, okay, if that guy makes this crossing here, I have good shots if I sit behind this island. This is a pretty comfortable island. Also, well, Tirpitz is not inside. Of course, I'm having a look on the Tirpitz. How much HP he has. Still not 100% sure that I'm going to that island here. But that's definitely the plan, if need be. And we see that the Tirpitz is pretty low, so I think the Atago and Hood can handle it. And even if there is a Normandy behind it, I think they should be able to do it. Alright, so my Roma and Amagi are showing a bit too much broadside towards the Richelieu, in my opinion. Probably because of the carrier striking them, dropping them non-stop, so now I can just do what the Charmatel is best at, farming damage on battleships. Already on fire. I mean, I don't have a speed boost, so I will glide out a bit, but this Richelieu is focused on the guys up there in the cap. Checking with the top launcher how fast he is, so I can adjust my aim. You have always time. I mean, the Charmatel was a bit nerfed with the introduction of the reload booster. His or its base reload was increased by 1 second, so it's 11 seconds. So during that 11 seconds, okay, with our AR, it's probably a bit less, probably 10 or 9. You have plenty of time to check the speed of your enemies. So I use, of course, reload booster because I want to set an additional fire home. Holy moly. to chunk him down pretty quick. And since he damage count, that's the obvious choice. That are the situations where you use your reload booster for. If you get broadside and you can utilize your AP. And yeah, somehow my Imagi and Roma achieve to die both to the Richelieu, which is of course not really great for us. And now I have to play again a bit aggressive. Because we are again on the back foot. This time I'm kind of confident that I will take him out in time. And there's a second fire that will stick. So now I can turn away. Was just waiting for the salvo, same like last time. Don't panic in these situations. I mean, if you get unlucky and you get hit and wrecked, okay, that's a different story, but yeah. Edinburgh gets a nice volley out. Because I slowed down, shouldn't have done that. I'm not sure, but I think the Edinburgh should be pennable with 203mm around everywhere as well. So you can't angle, but I'm not 100% sure. So now I'm missing the spotting here because my carrier is occupied there. And yeah. Without spotting, this is of course becoming a problem, especially when both ships are shooting AP. The Hipper that was spotted up there is also shooting AP. So I have to be a bit more careful. I'm torping preemptively if the Edinburgh comes around there. Staying angled away just to play it safe. I don't know where he's appearing, if he's appearing right of the island or left of the island. The only thing I know is they have to do something, they have to be aggressive, and yeah, therefore I'm waiting just for it. Okay, now it's clear where he's going. Using my reload booster exactly for that. And yeah, whiffed my first salvo, and the second one isn't shown. And yeah, that was not maximizing the max out of this reload booster, and it was my last one, but okay. Then I have to handle the Hipper right now, because my guns are pointed in that direction, and I angle myself towards the Edinburgh and start hammering the Hipper. Just because of that reason. I don't want to turn around, get my guns on the other side. Yeah, the Edinburgh is the low HP target, but this is just a decision of comfort, and yeah, gives me more time to shoot instead of wasting my time on turning my guns around or my ship. So I take some shots on the Edinburgh because he turned in, so I was able to not give too much broadside to the Hipper and still shoot him. And the Hipper is also running behind an island, so it should be fine, I think. He's going behind the island, so I should be safe. And as soon as he is behind the island, yeah, I get the Confederate Award. Using my AA to help out my Otago. AA on the Charmatel is pretty sufficient, at least it was. Or pretty good, actually. And yeah, now I'm loading AP and play it a bit more aggressive. I don't... Well, okay, Otago is going down, then we have might have an issue. So I risked something not to play it completely YOLO, but I will try as my best. Yeah, I'm thinking, yeah, should I play it super safe or should I play it like aggressive? And yeah, well, the decision is pretty easy for me since the Edinburgh is coming like this in front of my guns. Pretty unlucky, no Citadel though. Can somewhat angle against him. I expect, of course, torps from him. Now he tries to smoke up, which doesn't work out, and I kill him with a Citadel. And now the Hipper is left, gives me also full broadside. And I kill him as well. Sadly, no double strike. Carrier is coming to attack me, but yeah, at that point, 39 seconds in the game, I'm turning away because I expect torpedoes. But yeah, that's the game won for us. There's nothing really happening anymore. The carrier is too far away to damage him. And yeah, we let the clock tick down. And yeah, in the chat there is some, oh, well played and so on. Just 200k, I say. And yeah, that's the game, basically. All right. Let's go over to the results screen. Yeah, well, this was probably the highest damage game I ever had in the Charmatel. 200,000, especially in when you are top tier. That's kind of a whopping amount of damage, I would say. 4 kills, sadly no Kraken, but well, in the end, it counts what comes out of it, and that was the win, and that's more important to me, at least. And now you maybe understand what I mean if top tiers lift their weight. The Otago lifted his weight, even though the Hood as the mid tier did a good job, I guess, and yeah, on top myself. And that's what I mean is expected from people. And I think also that the basic speed is reflecting kind of, yeah, this statement more or less. I mean, I have to be honest, I was lucky with the first Richelieu, and I maybe was lucky with the second Richelieu, because I was both times really close to him, but I didn't want to show full broadside by panic turning away, so I two times tried to get or mitigate the damage and don't get devastated completely. If you're unlucky, it can happen, especially against higher tiers. I would not recommend to do that and stay on range on with the Charmatel for most of the game until it's anyways over, or you have to bring in your HP. That's the only case. But of course, against tier 10s, you want to play it a bit more safe, more in range. Don't play it too aggressive. Against tier 8s and tier 7s and tier 6s, you can play a bit more aggressive in the Charmatel. Alright, yeah. Damage consists mainly, of course, of HE. That's your bread and butter. HE and fires. But don't underestimate the AP. AP on the Charmatel is pretty pretty good. Has a good penetration, even over range, and nothing you should not utilize, I would say. And especially the reload booster is perfect for this. For these occasions, because if you see a target turning broadside, pop the reload booster, switch the ammo, because that happens also quicker. If you have expert loader, I think it is, then even quicker. So it just maximizes, and then you have AP loaded and can capitalize on shooting a broadside. So that's how I would utilize the reload booster or some battleship damage content, and you want to set additional fires afterwards with the reload booster. That's also the other one. Alright, yeah, folks, I hope you liked this video, and yeah, if you did so, give it a like. If you're new to my channel and you liked that video, maybe subscribe to the channel. Apart from that, I wish you a nice weekend, and yeah, I hope I can make some more videos, because Monday is patch day, probably most of the replays doesn't work, so yeah, I have a full day ahead of me, I guess. So, see you around, and bye-bye. Alright, almost forgot to make the ending with the captain build and modules, which I usually do. So here we are, and let's go quickly over it. I almost forgot. Alright, so when it comes to consumables, I would go repair party, of course. Defensive A, not necessarily. Fighter plane, also not necessarily, but speed boost is also a thing that the Charmatel benefits a lot of, so use it as a premium consumable. Reload booster, to have it available all the time or whenever it's needed, and you don't have to wait for it to be recharged, also premium in my opinion. These two not necessarily, but with a high CP population, you could even argue even those are kind of necessary to be premiums. Alright, so modules. Ta-da! Okay, I forgot one module. That's interesting. Let's put it in. First of all, armament, main armament modification 1. Then I have the speed boost module. If you don't have it, go for the propulsion module, because as I said, the steering, sorry. You saw it once in this last game. Your rudder tends to get knocked out by heavy HE shells, or if you eat the citadel in the mid part of the ship, then of course as well, or through the back. That can also happen sometimes in the Charmantel. So if you don't have this speed boost modification one, just go with the steering gear modification one. Holy moly! Then next would be to have some more or make it more annoying for carriers. You go with AA armament modification one, which gives you two more flap clouds on, I think, mid and long range. Experienced carrier players will be able to dodge it, but it's a nuisance, so put it in. This doesn't make too much sense, because cruiser dispersion is already pretty good. Here we have to check it. Rudder shift time with the module, 7.9 seconds. I think that's absolutely mandatory. Propulsion, yeah, you could argue that you stay on range and you speed up and slow down and reverse to juke off shots, then this might be helpful. So I think it's both are viable, even though I prefer the rudder shift module, in my opinion. If you want to go really fancy and you don't care about any concealment, then you can go double rudder shift, which makes the ship even more agile. But I still prefer concealment in this regard, because you don't have a heal, and making yourself invisible or making yourself able to disengage is really important. It's not a tier 9 cruiser or a tier 10 which have access to heal, so I would argue that this is still the way to go for. Yeah, makes you also more invisible to squadrons from the carriers, as I just saw it here, and the dispersion on of shells that are thrown at you or shot at you is also increased, so definitely worth it. When we come to the captain build, as I said in the video, it's my competitive captain from back in the days, and yeah, therefore I would change certain things if I just see it here. Yeah, let's do it and change it, because AFT is not as valuable as before. So priority target, pretty straightforward. Then you go for a Trenin rush. Your yeah, we'll go over it soon. You wanna have more consumables, I think, if I'm not mistaken. Oh, I'm not sure. How many do I have now? Three is not enough, especially in a pro in a long strong game. You need superintendent. You have a lot of consumables that are useful, so do it. Concealment expert, of course. And instead of AFT, you go with manual AA. That gives you it strengthens your AA way more than the AFT. In former times, AFT was pretty straightforward because it increased your AA range, but since this is not possible anymore, yeah, not recommended. Then, as I said, I played it with Last Stand for given reasons. As I said, this is more of a competitive build. You can leave it as well, especially on the Henri IV, you don't need it anymore, but on the Saint-Louis you need it, and yeah, if you can spare the doubloons and respec it for the Henri, because Henri is also, my Henri is for example using IFHE, which doesn't make sense on 203mm guns that you have on the Charmantel, but on the Henri with the 240mm, so you have to respec anyways. In this case, the French line is not as consistent. Then I went for Expert Marksman to have some more extra comfort, and then Expert Loader to switch the ammo types quick. Yeah, and that's basically my Charmantel competitive build. You can, and it's I think also good in randoms, could argue, okay, if you don't need so many consumables, you can go for Demolition Expert for some additional fires, also fine. Could also say, okay, I don't need Expert Marksman and Expert Loader, and you go for a Demolition Expert. That's up to you. I ran pretty good with this build, and I will stick to it. Alright, so that was the conclusion of the video. Thanks for watching, guys, and yeah, bye-bye.